right, guys, welcome back to this side cast of Replay with Doc for my friends here at SonyRumors.net. For these that don't know SonyRumors.net, you can find them on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Send us all your pictures of your gaming stuff so we can send them out. We'd love to hear what you guys have to say and see what you're playing. Today, we're going to talk exclusively with my good friend Jeff Burchett. Yes, that's a French name. Get over it. at Turtle Beach, and we're going to CES just closed their doors, so Turtle Beach had a lot of announcements and some big ones, and Jeff is here to talk with us about those. Jeff, how was CES, man?
CES was a blast, as always. You know, anytime you get to Las Vegas, you get to eat like a king, hang out, see a lot of cool stuff. Plus, there's all sorts of neat tech on the show floor, so you really can't go wrong.
Yeah, it's almost like a nerd paradise, isn't it?
It really kind of is. I mean, there's everything from mile-wide televisions that wrap around you like some kind of, I don't even know, surround vision television thing, to the craziest HDMI cables you've ever seen, and, of course, headsets.
Headsets. Oh, funny you mentioned headsets.
I know. Why would I ever do that?
So, you know, I'm a huge fan of Turtle Beach. It's what I use on almost everything I do, from earbuds to gaming to, you know, being on my iPad. And just when I think, you know, Turtle Beach can't get any bigger or more awesome, there's always something that Turtle Beach does just to crest the peak and go over the top, only to go over the top later again.
Well, thank you for noticing.
So tell us, well, first off, you guys have a partnership now. Can we talk about the merger with the sound?
Yeah, Parametric Sound Corporation. We can definitely talk about that. So basically, we're in the process of finalizing a merger with Parametric Sound Corporation. They are a tech firm that's been around for a while. They do audio technology. And they have this really amazing technology that we're calling hypersound. And it's pretty difficult for me to explain this without being able to demo it, so I'm going to give it the best shot I can. If you think about a light bulb in your room, and it's attached to a lamp, and the point of that light bulb is to kind of illuminate the whole room, and then you imagine either like a flashlight or a laser that has a light that doesn't necessarily tie into flood lighting, but it's a very directed beam. That's kind of the equivalence there for hypersound. So it's actually an ultrasound technology, and it, for lack of a better explanation here, what it actually does is shoots nearly like a laser of sound. It's extremely directional. If you are not literally standing directly in the beam, you can't hear it. It's totally silent.
Wow. I think my wife projects on that same frequency.
Yeah, I've met a few people like that too. But it's got some really cool applications. Number one, it can create a very private listening environment. So it's almost kind of like wearing headphones without wearing headphones.
Right.
The other thing that it has, which is and truly an amazing application, is that people, even with pretty severe hearing loss, can hear it very clearly.
So, well, that opens up to a whole range of products right there.
It really does. And we haven't been talking about any specific products with this. I mean, like I said, this merger is just going through. So we don't have a product on the roadmap. It's not like we have a special headset or a special set of speakers that's got this thing built into it at this point. Mm-hmm. It's just technology. It's something that we're going to work with the team at Parametric Sound Corporation as they, you know, get folded into the Turtle Beach umbrella. We're going to work with them to figure out really cool ways to bring this technology into people's houses and everything, and we'll see where it goes. But I've got to say, you know, gamers who have been playing with the sound, you know, not being able to hear it, it's going to be huge when all of a sudden it's like flipping that switch for them and they can hear their favorite games without having to wear a hearing aid or without having to deafen everybody else in the house by just turning it up to 11.
Right, right. 11. Why don't you just go to 11?
But this one goes to 11. I've been pushing for putting 11 on our headsets for so long, and nobody goes for it.
Oh, just like the, what's it, the XPPX 99,000 or whatever it was?
The XPPX 9001 and 9002. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I have a feeling that was your brainchild.
It may have been.
And still one of the best ads I have seen with you guys when you guys that was just ridiculously hilarious. I watched it multiple times.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it.
Now, currently, you know, because the PlayStation 4 is still it's still in its infancy on the market. A lot of people are still scrambling for what they're going to use for it. Some of them use, you know, the Sony one. You guys have the PX4 and the P4C, you know, P4C for chat and the PX4 to get your Dolby surround sound. I'm still using my XP7s. You know, I still wire those bad boys in, and you know, when I don't want to, I'd use the PX51 with the mobile cable attached to my controller, and it works great.
Yeah, well, you know, there's actually a PlayStation 4 chat adapter cable, and you can take it and plug it into that XP7, into the Xbox TalkBack cable, and then plug that into the controller's 3.5mm jack, and what you'll get is actually then Dolby surround sound plus really clear chat with independent adjustment on the XP7 control unit.
See, for those of you guys that have that, it's completely worth it. The XP7s are probably right now my favorite Turtle Beach headset. It's ridiculously versatile. For you guys that don't know, you can literally plug it into your phone, and you have an inline mic on the left side, just like on all Turtle Beach products. You plug it right into your mix amp, play, and then have it hardwired right to your phone. So when you get called from that significant other and you're, no, I'm not gaming.
I'm definitely washing the dishes right now this minute.
Right.
Not shooting people online and talking trash. I swear, cross my heart.
So now the Titanfall headset. I just want to touch on that because I just love the way it looks.
Well, thank you.
The Air Force Atlas, right?
That's right, yeah.
That is actually, and when I think about something cool, you know, that's tech looking, the design of that is great. I have no idea what it says on the side or even if that's a language. Is that?
No comment.
But it's the graphics of it are great, and I think that it's a great price too for that product. And
yeah, you really do get a lot, and I know this isn't like directly pertinent to PlayStation, but it's going to be the first headset in the world when it comes out that works on Xbox 360, One, and the PC, and mobile.
Yeah, that's a huge thing. It's definitely worth mentioning because it's actually a huge thing.
Yeah, I mean, just from a technological standpoint, it's pretty neat. We get to say that we're the first at a lot of things, but it always feels good. Like it never gets old saying you won.
Right. Now, for our illustrious PlayStation people, you guys are now going to be exclusively putting out, you know, licensed PlayStation products.
Yeah, so we've actually signed the deal with Sony, and we are officially licensed for PlayStation 3, 4, and Vita, which opens up a whole world of possibilities because, I mean, as you guys know, you can still buy brand new PlayStation 2s like right now today that it appears that Sony is still making. Sony is really awesome about supporting previous gen consoles for a long, long time. So that PlayStation 3 is not going to be going anywhere, and there's a lot of great games still coming out for it. I mean, stuff that we're still going to be seeing at conventions this year. Right. But it opens the door to do a lot of neat stuff. Once again, we don't have a specific product on the roadmap for this one. We were showing a concept piece at CES called the P47, which is the headset itself looked like a black and blue XP7. It's really sharp looking, but no real specific tech specs put down for that. Essentially, we're looking at the first one that we do that's licensed will most likely be wired and most likely be pretty high end for the PlayStation 4.
For our PlayStation 4 users, what would you recommend Turtle Beach wise?
Well, I mean, that depends. If there's the opportunity for us to sell you a cable instead of selling you a headset, as much as we would love to have the money from selling you a headset, we would like for you to have the better experience. So we would like to sell you a cable. So if you already have an Xbox 360 surround sound headset from us, we've got a cable that you can buy. It's just a few dollars. It's called a PlayStation 4 chat adapter cable, and it's on our site. So it, basically, if you've got a Turtle Beach headset that has a an optical plug on it, that's and it's for Xbox 360, that'll work. If you've got a TV with the red and white adapter or the RCA plugs on the back of it, and you've got a Turtle Beach headset that works on Xbox 360, this cable will work for you. We've got a chart up on our site, and it's at turtlebeach.com/console-compatibility. And that's a great place to go to look to see if you've already got a headset. But that said, if you don't already have a headset and you're looking for something, I'm really going to go ahead and recommend that PX4. It's a really nice headset. It sounds great. It lets you mix in, you know, your phone via Bluetooth so you can take phone calls through it. It's wireless, but it's got a wired mode so you can actually listen to music on the go with it, with the wire, even on the airplanes if they don't want to let you use the Bluetooth. It's got surround sound. It's got this teeny tiny little transmitter. It's about the size of a deck of cards. So it's not going to take up a bunch of room on your AV console or whatever you've got, or if you're playing, you know, I know a lot of guys play at the desk with their computer and they've got the PlayStation hooked into the monitor as well. So if you've got limited space, it's great for that. And of course, it's got the interference-free Wi-Fi on it too.
Excellent. Now for the Vita users, the Sony is now, it's going to be available in Japan here pretty soon. And I don't think they have a release date here for the U.S., but it's your little box that you can use your Vita basically as a standalone console for your TV.
Yeah, I've heard about that. That seems pretty sweet. I use my Vita a lot. I think it's a pretty awesome console.
Mm. I use my Vita the TuneIn app. I grew up in Southern California, so I listen to 106.7 K-Rock a lot. And through the TuneIn app on my Vita, I can listen to live what's going on in California and get my favorite radio station. And they keep adding new stuff to the Vita, and it keeps blowing me away.
Yeah, I've always thought, you know, and this is just me personally, not speaking for anybody corporate or anything, but I've always thought that the Vita felt like a companion for the PlayStation 4. I mean, the PSP came out kind of like in time to be a companion for the PlayStation 3. And I've always kind of expected that the PlayStation Vita would really find its sea legs when the PS4 was out. Right. So I'm really glad to see that they're doing a lot of cool stuff with it. That second screen capability is really, really sharp looking.
Yeah, and there's a game guide company that is currently trying to use that technology to have game guides on your Vita while you're playing the game. So if you're in your particular area looking for something, you'll have it right there on your Vita while you're controlling the game through your Vita right onto your TV.
Oh, that's nice. That's like Quest Helper in World of Warcraft. For any of you out there who are big enough nerds to know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, if you don't know WoW, you don't know nothing, man. If you don't even know what it is, you shouldn't probably be listening to this right now.
Turn it off. Turn it off right now. Well, no, don't really, but pretend like you didn't stay.
Yeah, and then learn something. Then you can tell other people, yeah, I know what you're talking about. So you like Skyrim, Jeff?
I am a Skyrim fanatic.
So how do you feel that they're bringing Skyrim to PlayStation 4?
I feel like I probably need to buy a copy.
That's
how I feel.
I was kind of torn myself because I was like, there is a ridiculous amount of my life inside the PS3 version of Skyrim. And now it's going to come out for PlayStation 4. And the only thing I can think about is every mistake I had made that I knew I had made and knew I should have gone a different way. I'm like, oh, now I can correct that and do something different. But
wouldn't
now,
that be so cool if you could do that in real life too? Just like replay the game?
Oh, absolutely.
Fix all the stupid stuff you've done.
Yes, you'd be like, oh, I'm going to turn left this time. I foresee a lot of time disappearing yet again into Skyrim. I was really happy and sad at the same time because there's other games that I'm not going to play because I know when Skyrim comes out for PlayStation 4, I'm going to jump in that and just disappear.
Yeah, and I played it on the PC, but I'm still really really kind of into playing it on PS4. I love that PS4 controller. So
yeah, a lot of feedback I'm getting from that, people are asking me, hey, you know, how do you feel about, have you gone back to a PS3 controller after the PS4? And have you done that? Have you had that experience?
Yeah, they did a really good job updating that controller.
Because when you go back to the PS3, you're like, how did I game so long with this controller?
Yeah, I mean, and I always thought the PS3 controller was really good, too. So I wasn't, I mean, I know there's some haters out there who never really liked it all that much, but I loved it. I don't know, but going to the PS4 controller is like, I don't know, it's like stepping into this model of your Ferrari.
Exactly. The only thing that can make it better is if, I'm just going to throw this company's name out there, Nyko. Nyko, they, back in PlayStation 1, they had the best controller idea. It was called the Nyko Airflow. And it had rubberized, raised grips. And it would allow, there was a fan inside that would blow air through these channels on the rubberized grips. And so your hands wouldn't sweat while you gamed.
Every year I see something like that at CES, and I don't know why it's not taking off.
I don't either, because I had the PlayStation 1. They had a PlayStation 2 one, and I got that one. There was one for PlayStation 3, but it was made by Power A, and it ended up getting stepped on during a karaoke night, and it didn't survive. But I just don't understand. If they could make a PlayStation 4 controller like that, I think it would finally take off.
Yeah, I mean, I think it probably would.
Because, I mean, people have enough time to understand, you know, what you need. And I've been on these. And I even talked to one of the Nyko people at E3. And they were like, well, we don't really see a demand for that. I'm like, do you even talk to gamers?
Like, I demand it right now. Make it. I demand.
Yeah, I was just like, can I get a, I mean, I'm not, you know, that cool. I'll be like, can I have just like a Doc branded one? You know, I'll sell at least 20. Come on.
If I don't, I'll just buy them myself. Like, whatever. Just make the thing.
Yeah, trust me. I didn't think about that. I'm like, I got 37,000 of these. Who wants one? Well, so for Vita, can you tell us anything for, is there any plans for anything special with Vita or anything currently existing that's going to be adapted to Vita?
So there's some stuff that we've got right now that's great for Vita. I mean, like the iSeries, which is actually kind of targeted at mobile users and especially Apple users.
Are we talking about the i30 and i60?
Yeah, the i30 is absolutely killer on the Vita. It's really, really nice, especially on the go. It's got the active noise cancellation. Mm-hmm. So if you're really, really tired of listening to bus noise or train noise or airplane noise or, you know, any of that sort of nonsense that you get when you're out and about traveling, it's a really solid option there. The M7 is a great headset for the Vita as well. If you've got an XP7 or a Z7, you've got an M7. And then the earbuds, any of our M line, that's a line that's kind of like, it's kind of aging out of existence, I guess. I mean, we're still supporting them, of course, because we support everything forever. But for the most part, I mean, I know somebody's going to call me on that. And we're going to be like, well, we have a Turtle Beach sound card from 1982, and I can't find drivers for Windows 8. let me just back that up. We support nearly everything for nearly ever. But we've got the M line of headsets and like the M135. There's earbuds, on-ears, over-ears, and they work really nicely with the Vita, too. And they're sort of tuned for that gaming soundscape.
Yeah, those. What, did they have 10-millimeter drivers in them?
Yeah, which is pretty hugeungus for in-ears.
Right. And because I use M1s with my Vita, and actually I use those on my iPhone.
Yeah, they're great.
And if you guys haven't had a chance to pick any of these up, if you can find them, I seriously, seriously recommend that you guys pick some of these up. Go to the Turtle Beach website, because I'm looking at them right now. I just typed it in real quick.
Yeah, if it's turtlebeach.com/M1.
And $59.95, and worth every effing penny. Actually, wait, I forgot, that was suddenly rumors. They're worth every fucking penny.
And dudes, they've got braided cables. Like, it's, they don't even knot up. It's amazing.
Also, the design was, I think the design was actually more innovative than anything else. I mean, there are ones that have those weird little expandable plastic pieces that expand into your ear, into the to the contours of your ear, and those get just problematic over time. But the M series, they go over your ears. If you guys don't know this, if you guys look them up, they're specifically angled. They will go flat into your ear. They're flush with your ear, the shape of your ear. And the wire, the braided outside, goes over your ear and back down. So you can literally, it's ridiculously comfortable. And if you put these on, that should do a really great job of blocking out a lot of noise, even when you don't have anything running through them. And when you do have something running through them, it's a complete different experience. I love these. And trust me, I've had these on while running the siren on my ambulance. You know, I've used them when I'm calling the hospital while we're in the middle of doing serious stuff, and they literally work. And also, Jeff, I have to tell you, so I took the P4C, right, that you were most gracious to send me to try out.
Yeah.
And so I had this thing on. We're in the back of my ambulance going code through the hospital, lights, sirens. There is bleed through because, you know, they're made for chat to have the holes for easy listening, so you're not just blocked on one ear. But I had this thing tucked into my vest. My phone's in the back. And I called in a report while I'm working with both hands with the P4C, and it worked like a boss, dude.
Yeah, you can you can actually use it if you've got a MacBook or something that's got the headphone jack that's the headphone and microphone, like your phone has on one port. It's the four-pole plug. You can actually use it on PC, so you can, you know, shout at your friends online, talk trash or whatever. It's cool, but it works on the phone too. I mean, you feel like a bit of a goon if you're out in public wearing it. Like,
Well, I don't, because, you know, we use large headsets with microphones. Well,
you don't because you have no shame.
Yeah, exactly.
But for anybody with any taste or sense of style at all, you might feel a little bit goofy. But it's still great. It's really comfortable. It sounds good, and it's got a big speaker. It's got a 40-millimeter speaker in there just so you can talk. And most commercial headsets and headphones that you buy that are like hundreds of dollars have 40-millimeter speakers in them. And most of ours have 50.
Right. I just want to backtrack for a second back to the I series.
Yeah.
The I series, when I up at PAX, when I got a chance to try both of those, the padded bar on the top, is that leather on the top?
It's a synthetic vegan leather. It actually feels just about like leather. It weathers a little better with the oil in your hair and skin, and no cows were harmed in its making.
Wait,
it's cool.
did you say it's made with vegans?
It is made from vegans. I've seen the ranch where we keep them.
Well, because I noticed it's half the size of the headband for the sevens, right? But strangely enough, it was actually more comfortable than the XP7s.
It's half the size and all the comfort. The iSeries stuff is really, I mean, it's like, it's legitimately premium. People throw that word around a lot, and I don't know. I feel like it's in, like, you know, Inigo Montoya from The Princess Bride. It's like, I do not think that word means what you think it means. They're properly premium.
Yeah, they are. And I was actually, because by far comfort wise, I'm down with the XP7s right now. Because I wear those all day when I'm yelling at people. but when I tried the i30s and the i60s, they both felt the same. But it was just, they felt like literally they were blocking everything out, but they felt ridiculously comfortable. It's just like, yeah. I don't feel the pressure on top of the ear or anything like that. I was just like, wow. And I think it's the fact that it was probably made with some really comfortable vegans.
It was, man. We feed our vegans nothing but the finest carrots before we make them into leather.
Oh, I'm going to the ranch. So now your line, you also have a license with Marvel.
Yeah, we basically everywhere you look, we've got relationships. Let me just run through the license list because it's pretty amazing. I was doing this at CES and I was like having to take a breath in the middle. So we're licensed with Microsoft. We're licensed with Sony, of course. We're licensed with Nintendo. We're licensed with Marvel. We're the official headset of Major League Gaming. We're the official headset of Twitch TV. We're officially licensed by EA and Respawn for Titanfall. We're licensed by Call of Duty. And I'm going to let you guys in a little secret. We've got another super secret squirrel level license that we're going to announce sometime in the coming days, weeks, months, years.
Dum, dum, sometime. Dum.
Bum, bum, bum. It's a big, big, fat, juicy partnership, and you guys are going to eat it up. I can't tell you anything more. Mwahaha.
But you heard it here. That's all that matters. You know what's coming. You heard it here.
That's right. There's your scoop.
Now, is there anything we failed to cover? I think we got... Did we fail to cover
it? What did we cover? Let's see. Well, there's PlayStation, and it's awesome. And there's some PlayStation products, and they're awesome.
Right.
We've got the other licensed stuff. So there's a couple things here. So we've got... I don't know if you guys have seen the PX22 in the past. So it's one of the officially licensed MLG headsets. And you can use it on the PlayStation 4. You can use it on the PlayStation 3. You can use it on the Vita. So if you're a Sony fan, it's a great headset for you. But we have done a few alternate colors on headsets in the past, but they're typically kind of like, oh, do I want it in the light gray or the black? They're fairly subdued. Mm-hmm. So we're not really like the kind of company that like jumps in your face and like shoves flashing lights and bright colors at you. We just like hand you a headset and it sounds awesome and you like your games more from it. But we've done this PX22, and it is like burn your retinas white. So if you are looking for something that's a little bit more aggressive in the styling, there's this PX22, which is, I think it looks really cool. And the thing, because I'm kind of a neat freak, the thing that I saw, I looked at it immediately, was like, oh God, it'll be dirty in 10 seconds. And I've got to tell you, you know, CES is a busy show, and it's like any other trade show where people walk around, they got food on their hands, they've, you know, the lines in the bathroom are 6 hours long, so nobody goes to the bathroom, nobody washes their hands, whatever. But these headsets look pristine. They don't have any dirt on them. So we've actually used some pretty cool plastics on them that don't really show the dirt. They're super bright white. Those are coming out. And we also have, by way of other in-your-face colorways on headsets, we did an Arctic camo of the X12, which is pretty gnarly looking. So if you're into camo and you're into hearing people online and stuff and yelling at your friends while you're wearing camo, it's a great headset.
Now, is that white? Is that the same that you guys use on the Phantom and the Spectre?
No, 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 no. It's like, you know that typing paper that you see that they advertise? It's like, I don't know, what do they say, like 700 brightness or something on it? But it really should be measured in lumens like a light bulb. It's like million candle power white.
Wow.
You should definitely check it out. It's when I say it's white, I don't mean it's like white. I mean it's white.
Like one of those, you're like, I can't see. It's so white.
Yeah, like don't shine halogen on it. You'll burn your retinas out. It's really cool, though. A lot of people really were into it.
Wow, that's ridiculously awesome.
Yeah. Marvel. Oh, I forgot. I have to interrupt you, so you have to wait.
No problem there.
With Marvel, what we talked about at CES is actually we have more plates coming. And
oh, no.
Yeah, so there's this little movie you guys might have heard of called Captain America, and it's coming out soon. And we have official Captain America Winter Soldier plates, so you can deck out your 7 series headset in those or pick up a Marvel 7 and support your favorite Marvel characters.
Oh,
we showed some Venom plates. We had all sorts of stuff, man. You missed out by not coming to CES. You know, that was a really noob move that you pulled by not showing up at the show. You're like, when is CES? And I'm like, it's tomorrow. Where is your ticket? Why are you not coming?
I completely spaced on it. I don't know what the heck got into me. And it was you when you messaged me, hey, you coming to CES? And I'm like, oh, okay, maybe I'll show up. What's going on? And you're like, you're late.
Dude, I was like totally ready to have like cookies there for you and Red Bulls and a chair and all sorts of stuff. And you totally let me down. I was absolutely bummed.
I guarantee that won't happen again. I guarantee.
There's another show called PAX. It's coming up. It's coming up in a couple months. You might have heard of it.
Yeah, I think it's going to catch on. I think the PAX thing is going to catch on. Just don't quote me on that, but I'm just saying.
It might happen.
It might. We got a bluegrass or an underground following somewhere. Now,
like that iPhone.
Yeah, that
iPhone. Kids and their crazy iPhone. They might one of these days mean something.
You know, Apple did announce that they're going to pull back on the iPod, man.
Are you serious? I haven't heard that. I've been in the CES bubble, so I don't really know what's going on in current events.
Yep, they're gonna stop the iPod, which, you know, is sad on one part, but it was just something that was bound to happen because, you know, our iPhones are getting better and better and better.
Yeah, but you can't get like a million gigawatt iPhone. That's the problem. I had an iPod for the longest time, and it was a 160 gig one.
Yep.
And that bad boy was full, and I loved it. I'm gonna have to go buy another one.
That's the thing I have a iPod Classic as well, and I mean 160 gigs. You're like, this thing is a powerhouse. It has, you know, half of my entire collection right there on it. And you know, for you guys that aren't into vinyl, you suck. But I like to take a lot of my vinyl. I like to hear the crackle of the needle in the vinyl.
Oh, it's so nice. Yeah. I was listening to vinyl this morning.
Oh, there you go. And that's like, oh my gosh, they better come out with 200 gig iPhone, because I'm like, if they're gonna stop making these, this is gonna be an issue.
It'd be $6,000 on contract.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Let's talk about you.
All right, let's do it.
First off, I'm going to ask you a question.
Okay.
Have you seen the Sound City Reel to Reel? Sound familiar? Ever heard of it?
I am familiar, but I have not seen it.
Dude, you have got to watch this music documentary.
Then I will do it. And we can talk about it the next time I'm on.
Absolutely. It's R-E-A-L to R-E-E-L. And I went, spent the extra moolah, and I got it on the soundtrack on double vinyl.
Ooh, that's nice.
And, of course, I bought it on CD as well. But Dave Grohl made this documentary. And
it
is probably, right now, my number one favorite is Pearl Jam 20. I mean, Spinal Tap's number one. If you guys didn't get the Spinal Tap reference earlier, then yeah, that was your second cue to leave. but Spinal Tap is always number one. And Pearl Jam 20, I'm really loving. But man, this Reel to Reel, and they've been playing it on Palladia a lot too. It is ridiculously so awesome that I was like, I'm telling my people that are into music, I'm like, have you seen this? You need to see this. So yes, if you get a chance, you need to see that, dude. And I'd love to get your opinion on that next time you're on.
I will. I'm gonna make it. It's my mission. I'm gonna do it.
Awesome. So tell us. This is the part. If you guys, if you haven't heard Replay with Doc, that was on the PlayStation Network inside PlayStation Home. Every time I have a guest on, and I've said this before, we'll love to get our, you know, to get to know our guests a little better. And Jeff, who's been on before, I love this guy. Always, because he's very musically inclined and a complete tech geek. I love to know the inner workings of his mousetrap. So, let's start off. What are you listening to?
I'm listening to a lot of stuff right now. I'll give you a few. As you know, I am into super duper awful sounding metal. Mm-hmm. There is a band, French band called Cult de Ghoul, that I have really been digging. They have an album out called Henbane. Two thumbs up. It's sort of like, I don't know, it's kind of like black metal, death metal, crust, nonsense. It's just madness. It's great. I was really digging that. Staying, of course, with the old favorites, Sisters of Mercy and all those guys.
Oh, really? Man.
I can't get away. I can't quit it. I can't quit you, Andrew Eldritch. I've been really enjoying some of the new Trent Reznor stuff that he's put out. I mean, despite the hate, I thought the new Nine Inch Nails album was pretty good. I mean, he's in a different place, right? How to Destroy Angels.
Well, that's the whole thing. I mean, that's the our favorite artist evolving, right? We want to see what's inside them. So yeah.
Yeah, man. Like, if you're still whining about the stuff that was bumming you out when you were 20, when you're like 45 years old, you have done life wrong. And then I actually bumped across, this is like my rare find of the day. I bumped across this artist called Zinovia, Z-I-N-O-V-I-A, and they're on the label Tympanic Audio, and you can source this stuff off of Bandcamp, but there's an album called The Gift of Affliction, which is sort of like industrial-inspired ambient future lounge, which is the strangest description I think I've ever attributed to a piece of music. It's quite good. I definitely recommend it. And then other one that is kind of a little bit hidden gem type stuff is this this dude who goes by the name Mosh, and you can find him at iammosh.bandcamp.com. And it's just like, I don't know, it's like French electro industrial buzzy nasty sound and dance music. It's great.
Oh, they have a very simple album cover. I'm looking at it right now. Empire.
Yeah, he's got two albums. He's got Empire. That's the latest one. And then there's the other one.
Monarchy.
Monarchy, yeah. Thank you for getting to that before I blanked on it.
No problem, bud. Oh, look at, oh man, I can jive on this all right here. Oh,
yeah, that. And his stuff's free.
That's crazy. $0.
So if it's free, that means you throw some money the artist's way, because that's how I release my music too.
Absolutely. Oh man. Wow, look at all these reviews. Wow. All right, I'll be checking that out tonight. All right, so any movies you see, theater or Blu-ray or DVD or VHS?
I'm not going to lie. I'm going to hang my head in shame while I say this. I am really excited to start watching Downton Abbey again tonight.
You know, I haven't gotten into that. But I'm seeing it everywhere. Okay, let's put it this way. David Jaffe is watching Downton Abbey.
Everybody's watching Downton Abbey, and only about 20 of us aren't lying to you about watching Downton Abbey. It's like when everybody was watching Twin Peaks and lying about not watching it, or you know, any of these sort of like slice of life soap type things. I mean, it's a guilty pleasure, but damn, it's good. It's so good.
I got to say something about Twin Peaks real quick. I'm here in Washington, the Pacific Northwest. I never lied about watching Twin Peaks. I thought,
Laura, well, you get the free pass.
Laura Palmer, I thought, oh, man, she's kind of cute. And then Sherilyn Finn? Or
Yeah,
Sherilyn Finn was on there. And I was like, oh, my gosh, they were together. And I'm like, oh, baby Jesus. down here on my way to Seattle, I stopped off in North Bend, and we took a right. And we were in our ambulance. We're on duty, and hanging right. My buddy's like, "I want to go down here get a slice of pie from this place." I'm like, "Who stops to get a slice of pie, dude?" And he's like, "Trust me." So we pull off. I get out.
Sounds like a euphemism.
Yeah, exactly. I am not joking, dude. Tweed's Cafe is real.
Really?
And it still looks exactly like the series.
And oh my god, it would have to.
Yeah, and it still serves the pie. The pie, they still serve, and it's a huge hit there. And I'm like, wait a second. I was like, it's Tweeds! And I flipped a geek gasket, dude.
That's fantastic. If I'm ever out there, we're going to get pie.
Oh, absolutely. My trade. Yeah, absolutely, dude. And if we're at PAX, we can literally make that trip right after the show, just roll out there. And then find 27 beers on the way back. But
well, I will totally be at PAX. I'll be at all the PAXes.
Sweet. So, anything on TV? I mean, you're a busy guy, but I just have to ask.
I'm terrible at television. I mean, like, legitimately bad. If it doesn't come on Netflix, or if it doesn't completely get me obsessed like Downton Abbey, then I'm really not good at watching it. I watched Sherlock. I watched both seasons of Sherlock recently, and that was really good.
The BBC version with Benedict Cumberbatch?
Benedict Cumberbatch, yes. Isn't that the best name?
I keep telling people, like, this is the best name ever.
It's so much fun to say. If you get a name that's fun to say, then that's all there is. I watched that. I've watched a bunch of the episodes of Arrow lately, which I thought was pretty good. I'm not gonna lie. I came into that a little bit jaded. I didn't think it was gonna be very good.
I'm with you. I'm exactly. I was exactly in the same position.
I just kind of looked at it and I was like, this is either gonna be pure cheese or it's just a vehicle to show off pretty people. But it was good.
I pretty much knew the fans had accepted Arrow when they made the new Arrow a downloadable skin for Injustice.
Yeah, I sort of got that impression too. That was one of the things that sort of tipped me off. I was like, maybe this is okay. Injustice is great, by the way.
Yeah, it is.
I definitely want to check out on PS4.
Oh yeah, now because you can get the Ultimate Edition that has, you literally buy the game and has all the downloadable content that was available for PlayStation 3.
Yes.
It's, you buy it and you get everything. For those of you that haven't watched Sherlock, the BBC version, it is awesome. And for you smart people, I'm going to throw this in there for you that don't know. I can't remember the name of the actor that plays that's his counterpart on Sherlock. Dang, I can't remember.
The Hobbit, Martin Freeman.
Yes, yes. So you guys don't know it. And that excellent segue right there, they work together again in The Hobbit because Benedict Cumberbatch is also the voice of Smaug.
Yeah, I liked The Hobbit too. I was a little disappointed at how much of a left turn the second one was from the novel. But I still really liked it. I mean, like, I'm a sucker for big sprawling adventures with dragons and elves and swords and running around outside and all that stuff that I wish I could do in real life. So I mean, the first trilogy I thought was great, and anything Peter Jackson does, I'm sold on. So, it's good.
Anything, Peter Jackson, anything.
Are you going like back in the vaults for what was that? Dead Alive.
Yeah, boy.
That was when I knew. Like that was when I knew that Peter Jackson had his ducks in a row.
When I heard Peter Jackson was directing the trilogy, I was like, wait. The guy that invented Zingaya?
Yeah, I was like, wait a second. Dead Alive, dude? It's Wait a minute here.
If you haven't seen Dead Alive, I suggest you, one, immediately go find it somewhere. Two, make sure it's the unrated version because you will never, ever, ever in your life find a better use for for a fucking lawnmower in your life.
So good. That movie, you know actually what movie that reminds me of, and they're not even related at all, but there's this movie called Black Sheep. And have you seen Black Sheep with the sheep? Yeah. The zombie sheep?
Yeah, dude. Oh,
it's so good.
I have a poster and it's in my stack of posters. It hasn't been framed and it's got the sheep with the foot in the mouth and it says, you know, New Zealand has 10,000 sheep, you know, and they're all angry.
It's such an that was another one that my wife was like, you should check out this movie, and it's not the one with Chris Farley, by the way.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like I just looked it up. Here we go. There are 40 million sheep in New Zealand, and they're pissed off. It's only got a 5.8 user rating on IMDb, but that's apparently because, you know, people are dumb or something. I don't know. Whatever. If you don't like this movie, you don't have any taste. I'll put it out there. Like, that's all there is to it.
Exactly.
If you don't like it, there's nothing wrong with the movie. You are the problem.
Those people rated it are the same people that watch Dawson's Creek. I'm just saying.
Yeah, it's not me. It's you. So it's great. It's this like completely out there horror comedy about these sheep and genetic engineering and zombies, and that's
yeah,
it's everything it should be.
There's one scene that I don't want to spoil it, but it was yeah, you know what I'm talking about, right? When he's naked and the sheep bites him, and
yes.
I was the point. I was like, oh hell no.
Oh, and I'm also on a quest. My wife and I are like, anytime anybody comes into our house, we're like, have you seen the movie Tucker and Dale versus Evil? And if the answer is no, basically what we do is we just put them on the couch. We're like, you're watching it now. And if you try to leave, we'll cut your legs off. So Tucker and Dale versus Evil, if you have not seen it, it's your new favorite movie. It's got great people in it. It's got Alan Tudyk in it.
Yeah.
So if you're a Firefly fan,
right,
you know. But it was directed by Eli Craig, and it's this sort of like completely off the wall horror movie. But if you've seen Deliverance, you know you get the sort of the terrifying redneck,
right,
who is rampaging about. So in this movie, it sort of turns everything on its head, and it's basically these two dudes, Tucker and Dale, and they're on vacation, and they've just bought this vacation home, and it is positively falling apart around them. And then they're attacked by a group of preppy college kids.
Yep.
What happens?
It's still on Netflix, isn't it?
Yeah, it's on Netflix. I think it's on Amazon Prime streaming. But it doesn't matter where you have to go to get it. Like, if you have to pay $100 to get this movie, just pay it and watch it. Like, it will pay dividends. It's great.
Yeah, the only reason I watched it is because I'm a huge Firefly fan. And I was like, oh, I'm going to check out, you know. I'll see it, you know, because there's always those gems that you just happen to run across. And I was like, I had to, like, my wife, I'm like, honey, you have got to watch this. And and she was like, I think that was either the most genius movie I've ever seen or something I'm never going to watch again. And I was like,
oh, it's great.
It's so awesome.
I know what this is. It's a suicide pact.
So you guys have actually gotten a lot of information on some underground stuff that's below the mainstream, which should be above the mainstream of what my consideration it sure the hell is, because
says we're just too cool for the mainstream. That's what's up.
Oh yeah, it's not turning into the hipster podcast.
Hold on, I'm gonna put my scarf on.
Yeah, I already had mine on. I'm drinking my coffee French pressed because I don't do brewed.
Ooh, nice.
So,
but it's better that way,
right? Oh yeah, I actually do French press my coffee.
Me too.
Yeah, I grind it fresh because I'm just that guy. I'm like, no, it has to be a certain type of bean kept in the dark. I need the oils, you know. And people are like, I just get it from Folgers. I'm like, you leave now.
you're not allowed in here.
So the one thing I failed to ask you: are you playing anything?
Guitar.
Video game wise.
I'm playing a lot of stuff. So I'm a sucker. The Steam sale just happened, and I bought every game on Steam, I think. There's like 12,000 of them, and I own them all now. I played Counter-Strike 1.6 for a long time.
Nice.
And it was cool. It was fun. And I just picked up Counter-Strike Go, and it is like... I'm having as much fun as I did playing Unreal Tournament with Counter-Strike Go. Like, I'm screaming and swearing at the screen, and it's awesome. I'm playing that. I'm still playing Street Fighter, of course. But I don't really have a whole awful lot of time for video games. I guess the last, like, big epic thing that I really finished up was GTA 5, and then before that, Tomb Raider. Both of which I give two thumbs up wholeheartedly.
Tomb Raider will also be making an appearance on PlayStation 4.
Yeah, I would really like to play that. I almost picked it up on PC. I've got it on PS3, of course, and I played it through there. And I almost got it on PC, but I decided I'd just wait for the PlayStation 4 to get it.
Right. I was really disheartened that, you know, a lot of so-called critics, you know, couldn't take it seriously because of a female lead, and that's what it boiled down to. And I was like, wow, these people are missing out on a really good update to an honest series.
I don't understand what that is. It's so much of it in the games industry, like how people want to turn. They want every woman to be Princess Peach.
Right.
Right. Get rescued by Mario. And that's cool. That's fun. But, you know, some women need rescuing from the nasty fire-breathing turtle. And so do some men. And some don't. And it's really disappointing to me when I see a game that just gets panned for something like that, or a game that gets, you know, all kinds of sort of positive attention for just turning women to outright objects. It really kills me.
Yeah,
does not sit well with me at all.
Did you play Last of Us?
I played part of Last of Us, and as I'm sure you remember. I am awful at video games. I love video games, but I am terrible. I mean, like, I play games on easy, and I typically sort of, like, futz along, and it's not an easy thing. Last of Us broke my spirit. And I got through a good chunk of it, and then I loaned it to a friend. So I should probably get back to it and take another stab at it, but... The Last of Us beat me, man. I didn't beat it. It beat me.
That game, I don't think, even though all the praise it's gotten, I don't think it's gotten enough yet because they put so much heart into it. And, you know, it's more for the cerebral gamers than it is, you know, the running gunners or the
questers. I watched a lot of actually Let's Play content on it because I was really into it. And I just was like, how about somebody else play this and I'll just like hang out and enjoy. And I actually really enjoyed watching it get streamed. I thought it was really cool.
Agreed.
And Final Fantasy 14. I've been playing some Final Fantasy 14. I haven't for about, I don't know, a month and a half now, because I actually just moved. So we let our subscription lapse while we were unpacking boxes, and then there's, you know, travel and holidays and all that. So I just kind of like let it chill, but probably be re-upping on that. And that's another one that's coming to PlayStation 4. It's out on PS3 right now too. So if you're a PlayStation fan looking for a great MMO and not really into the PC space, Final Fantasy 14 is awesome. Like, I know the first iteration of that game was one blunder after another. I didn't play it, but I saw, and I had friends who did. But Final Fantasy 14 is like, you step back into it, and it's like, if you're an MMO player, you know that feeling that you got the first time you started playing an MMO, and you're like, yeah, this is right. Final Fantasy 14 did that for me. It was like, yeah, this is right. This is an MMO. I want to play this game. It's cool. It looks beautiful, too.
Absolutely agreed. Okay, well, unless you're reading anything, that's it. Do you still touch paper? I mean, a lot of people don't.
I do touch paper. I actually just read two comics that are really good. I read The Collected Trade of Ghosted, which is fantastic. It's a sort of horror noir mystery. It's very good. I would recommend it highly. And then the other one that I read was the first trade of Revival, which is a sort of rural noir rising from the dead, not zombies horror thing. I don't know. It's really good. I would say both of those are definitely on the top of the list. And then I finished up the first book just a couple weeks ago in Guillermo del Toro's The Strain trilogy.
Ooh.
Which I thought, I was like, oh God, a couple people were like, you got to read this. You got to read this. It's really good. And I was like, oh really? Jesus, another vampire story. And I was like, I'm done to death with vampires. Once they started sparkling, I was over vampires.
Pretty much.
And this might have changed my mind. The vampires in the Strain trilogy, for any of you who are totally unfamiliar, they're not sparkly. They're not even like Tom Cruise dapper in Interview with a Vampire. They are bloodthirsty, rampaging, psychopathic death robots. And they just like run around and destroy things. So that's really, really good. I really enjoyed that book. It was a lot of fun. It's a quick read, but it's good.
Now, if we could only unleash those on the sissy glittery ones.
Ah, that would be so nice.
I'd pay money to see that one. And, you know, I myself collect hardback books. You know, there's nothing like having an actual physical book in a... You know, sitting down with a book, turning the pages. Because, you know, even though I love tech, I also appreciate tech so much because I can have those moments, you know, where I'm not involved in any. It's just a book, man.
Yeah, it's the juxtaposition of it. Like, I don't even like playing acoustic guitar, but sometimes I want to play mine. It's the same thing, you know. Sometimes you just want to unplug and feel something that's, like, there and real, and it doesn't need anything other than you and it to do all it can do.
Yep. Okay, any shout-outs, my friend?
I have one shout-out, shameless bit of self-promotion here. I am now working with Fixer Studios as well. We are kind of putting together this really cool game, and I can't tell you very much about it, but it's called Sinister Dexter, and we have just released our first live-action trailer for it, and it's up at facebook.com/Fixer Studios.
One more time.
facebook.com. Fixer Studios. It's really cool. Come check it out. I'm doing the music for it. There's some ex-PopCap folks in there, some folks from the comic scenes. If any of your fans here are familiar with Writhe and Shine, which is a really fun online webcomic, or this little game is called Bejeweled Blitz, or Battle Nations. You guys might have heard of some of this stuff. Some of those folks are working on this project, but it's really cool, and you should check it out because we want you to come play this game and love it.
And I want you to, too, so go check it out.
Yeah, and I heard it's got great music.
Well, Jeff, I thank you for your time again, bud. As you know, I love everything that you guys are doing, and I always look forward to what's coming next because, I mean, I'm running out of space. For my headsets. I mean, first world problem, right? I'm going to game. What headset do I use?
Like, oh, today I think I will wear the black one.
Exactly.
Jeeves, bring it hither.
And you guys have made it worse with your interchangeable plates. I'm just throwing it.
Oh, you got to check it out on the site. The collection of stuff that we have for plates, especially the Marvel stuff, is going to, like, it's going to blow your mind.
Because when you said Winter Soldier, I'm like, okay, I've got to get it. And I was really upset with, sorry, I had to backtrack, but for you guys that are listening, we're going extra. The Winter Soldier.
Shoot for the price of one today.
Winter Soldier. Huge. It was a great story. And for some people, I love Starbucks is one of my favorite places to sit. Me and my wife would go on Sundays and, you know, we'll have coffee with our tech and we'll talk and, you know, share funny cat videos, stuff like that. And I love to listen to the people talk because usually they're talking about shit they have no idea about. You know, they're just like, oh, I saw this on the TV or someone told me this. So it's how it is. And I heard two fairly younger guys talking about the Winter Soldier. And they're like, oh, yeah, it's because Captain America, yeah, it's still in Europe and it's cold. And I was like, what? And I, you know, and I'm like, oh, I so have to listen to this conversation.
Really? It's actually because the movie was released in America in the winter. For anybody who doesn't know the true story of this, that's why. So get your facts straight.
And his buddy, of course, had his counterpoint. He's like, no. It's because Captain America was frozen in ice. Thus, he is the Winter Soldier. He's like, didn't you know that? And I was just like, I just wanted to go over there and be like, hey, so does Bucky Barnes come back? And they're like,
crickets.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. for these that don't know, I'm not going to spoil it for you, but it's out there on the internet, so you can go spoil it for yourself. But yeah, the Winter Soldier, I'm really, 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 really looking forward to that.
You can put Captain America's sweet, sweet shield on the side of your 7 headset now.
Yeah, that's super, super, super soldier cool. I'm just...
It's pretty rad. I've heard that you can actually throw it and it'll come back to you too. Oh. That's not been tested though, so don't quote me on that.
So when you're about to rage quit that game, you're like, oh, it came back.
Yep.
Okay, so thanks for sharing with us about everything that's going on with Turtle Beach. I really appreciate it. Like I said, I love you guys, and congratulations on your move. And you're always doing something cool, so keep on doing what you're keeping on doing, dude. Because there's only a few cool people left in this world.
Yeah. What do they say? You keep moving or you die, right?
Right. Right. Unless you're camping, then you just die.
Yeah, and everybody hates you, so it's cool.
So, Jeff, thanks again for being here.
Yeah, thank you very much.
For you guys, thanks for tuning in to this sidecast of Replay with Doc, but it's definitely Sony Rumors, so pay close attention because the Sony Rumors podcast will be in full swing soon. Shout out to my boy, Sarab. Thanks for all your support, buddy. And don't forget, you can find Sony Rumors on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. We want to see what you are doing game-wise. Ask us anything you want. And you can find me at doc_gamer. If you can't spell that, we shouldn't be talking. And I'll be happy to answer all your questions. And if you want to see something cool, just go over to turtlebeach.com. You'll find all the stuff that Jeff and I spoke about. And I look forward to seeing what you guys are doing PlayStation 4-wise. So we'll see you next time. Say bye, Jeff!
Take it easy, guys. Thanks for having me.